Someone a great big round of applause. Let us turn with you today in the Word of God to Hosea chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. And we're going to look at those verses there for a moment. I believe that God is getting ready to do something great and mighty, and I think He's doing it already.
Amen.
Just not as prevalent as in other countries as America, amen. In other countries, there's being dead people raised back to life. There's being creative miracles done. God is doing extraordinary things. But in America, I believe that God is trying to shake and wake American people.
Yes, amen.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
I know that sometimes we in America get caught up in all the mayhem of everything that's going on around us, and sometimes God is left out of the picture. Mm-hmm. I say all the time that if God isn't first in your life, then He's not really in your life.
Amen.
See, He's got to be first in your life.
Yes.
If He's not Lord of all, He's not Lord at all. So God wants you to put Him first in your life.
Yes.
And I believe that as you do that, God is going to begin to do something great in your life.
Amen.
Now, I don't stand here today professing perfection, because all of us don't have a perfect life.
Amen.
But I do stand here today saying that my righteousness is in Christ Jesus.
Amen. Hallelujah.
He's the reason why we're able to get saved and able to remain saved and able, amen, to the end of this life, so we can endure to the end. And the Bible says, so shall you be saved.
Amen.
So we're saved, being saved, and if we endure to the end, we shall be saved. Amen.
Amen.
Let's look at the Word of God. Hosea chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. It says, come. Come. That's the first word it says, and that's the first word I want to talk to you about. Come. First of all, you got to come.
Amen.
The Bible says, all you that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled.
Yeah.
But first of all, you got to come in order to be filled.
That's right.
If somebody invites you to supper and you don't show up, guess what? You ain't going to eat.
No.
And if someone invites you to the house of God and you don't show up, guess what?
Yes.
You're not going to be fed.
Right.
So God wants you, first of all, to come. Is it important to come to God's house? Sure it is. Because we come together as believers to edify not only one another, but to learn the Word of the living God.
Amen.
You're not going to fight the devil with anything except the sword of the Spirit. That is the only weapon that you have, and that weapon is the eternal Word of the living God. That's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So the Word of God says, come. And many of you have come. You've come to the altar somewhere, and you've shed tears, and you've confessed your sins, and you believe God. That's the first step. That's the first step. You'll find that there will be up and down places in your life. How many's found that?
Amen.
And you'll find that it just won't be one smooth road. Along with the beautiful roads in the world, amen, there's thorns. And sometimes you experience those thorns in your life. But those trials and those tribulations should make you better. Count it all joy, the Word of God says, when you fall into diverse tribulations and temptations, amen. When God begins to allow you to walk through this life, He strengthens you by those things you face in life. But if you endure, God is going to strengthen you so that you find your path a little bit easier as you go through this life.
Amen.
It says, and let us return unto the Lord. He hath smitten and He will bind us up. When God disciplines you, He'll also come along and He'll heal you.
Yeah.
So God doesn't, amen, discipline you at a point of giving you cancer. That's not God. He doesn't break your leg. That's not God. But God will use things that come, amen, and allow you to be smitten so that there'll come a day when you call on Him. And the Word of God says, all that call on Him, He will hear them if they are righteous, amen, if they are a believer in Jesus Christ. So God wants to bind you up. Some of you are here today, and you're outcast. You feel like nobody, amen, except you, are going through what you're going through. But the Bible says that God came to gather together the outcast of Israel, to bind up their wounds and to heal their broken heart. How many this morning can relate to that scripture? Amen. You have a broken heart, but God's come to heal that broken heart. I want to tell you, don't ever get discouraged to the point that you give up on God. Don't get discouraged to the point that you start missing church. That's just what the devil wants you to do. He doesn't want you to come. He doesn't want you to get fed. He doesn't want you to get strong. He doesn't want you to get over the obstacles that the devil sometimes places in your way. So the Word of God says, after 2 days will He revive us, and the third day He will raise us up, and we shall live in His sight. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord.
Amen.
How many can follow on to know the Lord?
Amen.
See, it's not knowing the Lord and quitting. Quitters never win, and winners never quit.
That's right.
It's following the Lord and continuing to follow the Lord. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. Amen. It's not just a one-day thing. It's not just a one-day experience with God. How many felt good when you first got Jesus in your heart? You know, you felt that overwhelming love come down, and you felt, amen, that you wanted to share Jesus with everybody, but then you went home and some of the same old things that you left at the house was still there. I tell people all the time, that baggage is with you because it belongs to you. You can't move away from it. You can't run from it. It's always there. So you need somebody to help you with that baggage. That's why I said, cast your cares upon me, because I care for thee.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus wants to carry all your grief and all your sorrow. He wants to help you in every day, amen, life. He's concerned about everything that concerns you, but you've got to follow on to know the Lord.
Yes, amen.
You've got to take up our cross. The Word of God says, when Jesus tells us, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. How do you learn about God? I don't know about you, but I read the Bible, study the Bible, listen to DVDs in the recorder, amen, and play the Bible in my vehicles. That's the way I get in a contact with God's Word. So how do we contact God then? By prayer. That's why 20 minutes before service or 30 minutes before service, you'll find some people here in the church gathering to pray. If you don't pray, you're never going to get in touch with God. God listens to the prayer of a righteous person. Amen. Man or woman, child, doesn't make any difference. God listens to the prayer of a righteous person. So we need to know that God's with us. Amen. His burden is light. But we've got to know God, and we've got to follow on to know God, and we've got to learn about God. If you don't come to church, it's probably obvious that you're not going to learn a whole lot about God, because I find in the last 30-some years of my relationship with God, when I talk with people in the church, very few ever pick the Bible up and read it. How many knows that? Looks pretty on your coffee table. But it's not to be on your coffee table, it's to be in your heart. David said, I've written the Word of God upon my heart that I might not sin against my God. Why does that help him not sin against God? Because the Word of God will bring conviction when you're out there doing things you know you shouldn't do.
Uh-huh.
We've been talking about this.
Yes.
Sinners love to sin, but saints hate to sin.
Right.
Amen. Doesn't mean you're not going to sin, but when you do it, there's going to be a pricking in your heart. And you're going to realize that you're doing something wrong, and God's going to say, halt, hold on, stop. And if you go on, amen, then you've got to do some confessing, don't you?
Amen.
Then he goes on to say that, and he shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. Folks, we are the earth.
Yes, we are.
We are the earth. And when it rains, it clears the air, and everything begins to grow. How many knows that?
Hallelujah.
All that pollen and everything that's floating around in the atmosphere, when the rain comes down, it all goes down with the rain and begins to settle upon the earth. When you're mowing your grass this year, you realize every time it rains, your grass grows a little bit, doesn't it? Your flowers blossom. Amen. They get greener. God is showing us that in this day and hour that He can send us the rain. Amen. And that rain represents a shower of blessing. It represents a revival in the church. We need revival more than we need our next breath. You look around the church today, I think I counted quite a few people missing. We need revival. Amen. The reason why revival comes to a church isn't for the sinner out there, it's for the church. Revival is to revive the church people, to revive them to the point that they get a burden for lost souls. We don't see much of a burden for lost souls today. Most of us are afraid to tell people anything about the Word of God. I'm here to tell you the Word of God is true if every man's alive. That's what God's Word says. The Bible teaches us there's not only a heaven, but there's a hell. You're going to one or the other, amen. There's no in between. There's no purgatory. You're going to heaven or you're going to hell. But I want to tell you this morning, it's easy to go to heaven. It's not hard. The way of the transgressor, the Word of God says, is hard. But Jesus said, take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That right there tells you the way, amen, to God is a much clearer way and a much easier path than it is for the sinner. The sinner may enjoy sin for a short season, but we're going to enjoy life for eternity. I said the sinner might enjoy sin for a short season, but we're going to enjoy life eternal. Man, think about it just for a moment. Get real with God. Because God wants to be real with you. God wants you to realize that there's nothing more important to Him than you. Now, does that bring it down home? If there was nobody in this world but you, Jesus would have still died on that old rugged cross. When God breathed into the nostrils of man, He became a living soul. What's that mean to you? He became, amen, a part of God. God put part of Him into the man. And now man has a big void in their life. Many people try to fill it with drugs. Many people try to fill it with alcohol, sex, and everything else. But that void never goes away until you fill it with Jesus. I want to tell you sometimes. Sometimes we're praying to God and God sends us a miracle. How many knows that? A miracle can come in many different ways. A miracle can come by somebody blessing you. A miracle can come by somebody encouraging you. A miracle can come by you coming to church and being edified by the Word of God or built up in your faith so that you can get over the hump. Miracles come in many different ways. But I find that a lot of people, when they're praying and say, God, give me a miracle, the miracle comes. And sometimes instead of praising God for the miracle, we begin to talk about what we think brought the miracle. Let me tell you, it's not about what you think brought you the miracle. God may send you a mailman to deliver the miracle. God may send you an individual to deliver the miracle. But God is the giver of the miracles. And I believe we're living in an age of miracles if we'll believe God. Amen. I want that rain, and I want it in this church. The latter rain and the former rain. God has a plan for the church, but you have to trust Him and live in that plan. Once again, winners never quit, and quitters never win. And he that endures to the end shall be saved. So if you look in the Word of God in the book of Tribulations talking about the churches, you'll find all those who overcome are blessed. How many is an overcomer? You know the mark of an overcomer? Is someone who didn't give up. See, I know preachers that have preached just as long as I have, but they've been in church and out of church. What's the difference, Sister Mary? There's a difference. There's no endurance there. See, I've known some that they preached for a little while because God didn't do everything they thought God should do. They quit. You didn't see them back in church for a year or two, and then they're pastoring a church. There's some you can find on the street, and they used to be preachers and used to preach the Word of God. Now they don't preach the Word of God at all. Don't go to church. But you might find them pastoring a week or two from now. I want to tell you something. The endurance comes when you make mistakes, when you fail God, but you're just like David. Amen. You say, God, I'm keep going. Amen. I know I've sinned. I know I've wronged you. I know I've done harm. I've hurt people, but God, I'm going to stay on. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all His benefits. He heals me of all my sicknesses, forgives me of all my sins. Can you say amen? David knew if he'd humble himself under the hand of God, that God, amen, would come through for him.
Amen.
When Nathan come to him, Nathan didn't say, David, God's not going to forgive you of your sins, did he? He said, God's forgiven you.
That's right.
But God has also placed judgment. The sword is never going to leave your house, David. Because of the sin you've committed, problems are going to filter down through your family. Your own family's going to turn against you. One of your boys is going to turn against you and try to take the kingdom from you. How many knows that's a fact? Read it. Absalom killed his half-brother Amon. Amen. Because he had raped his sister Tamar. I want to tell you something. You can begin to live that dog's life if you want to. But I want to tell you something. God wants to lift you up out of that muck and mire. He wants to take you further than you've ever been. Show you more than you've ever saw. Amen. And bless you more than you can stand. But you got to remember God's got a plan. He's got a plan for me. He's got a plan for you. Are you going to walk in the plan, the will of God? The Word of God says the steps of a righteous man, they are ordered by the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
See, some things by chance they walk into a church. Some got invited. Let me tell you something. God is always giving direction in your life. And the reason why God does that is so somebody can come to you and tell you about Jesus.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter how you get there as long as you get there.
Amen.
And I'm not worried if I get there by bus, train, airplane, whatever. Just let me get to my destination. And my destination now is heaven.
Amen.
What's yours? Can you say amen? The Word of God says, come, let us return to the Lord. How shall we return? There's four things the church needs to do to have revival. That's to humble themselves. That's to pray. Seek God and repent. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people, God's not waiting on the world, folks. God is waiting on the church.
Amen.
He didn't say if the world. He said if my people, which are called by my name, and they were first called Christians at Antioch, the word Christian means Christ-like. Amen. He said if you that are Christ-like, that call yourself Christians, amen, shall humble themselves and pray. Not be part of the problem by stirring up strife and division, but by being part of the solution by praying and fasting. Then he says, and seek my face.
Amen.
I think sometimes if people spend more time seeking the face of God than they would standing in front of somebody else's face complaining and murmuring and talking,
yes,
we'd already had revival.
Yes.
Do you realize that when you take the statistics of American people, amen, that we have an overwhelming majority of folks that say that they're Christians. Well, for Christians, why is this country of ours going down the tubes? If God, amen, seemed that we were truly a Christian nation, we'd be blessed even more than we're blessed right now. But God is beginning to put judgment on America. For the 50 million children that have been sacrificed under the name of abortion. I want to tell you something. God will forgive you, but that's wrong. And I don't care what pastor or who tells you it's right. You can't make something wrong right.
That's right.
So you might think, well, you know, I got divorced and married somebody else, and I was in church at the time, but They were better than my husband was, or they were better than my wife was. Let me tell you, you can't make it right by that.
No.
You can't make it right by that. If you're in church, there's no good reason for you to get a divorce except that the one goes outside the marriages and commits adultery. That's the only way for divorce. But you know, statistically, the divorce rate is higher in the American church than it is out in the world. Why is that? And then we wonder why God is not doing the miracles that He used to do. We're wondering why we don't see the lame walk. We're wondering why we don't see the blind see, the deaf ears unstopped. We're wondering why we don't see cancer die in the bodies of believers, amen. We're wondering why, but we need to get back to the power of God. Why do we have people in America, amen, that sit in churches every Sunday, probably, most likely, demon-possessed, but nobody's ever detected it? See, I came up when there was a revival sweeping this land. When God was moving in a great way. God can do that again. But it's up to you. It's up to me. And the Bible says we're to seek His face. Sin hides the face of God from us. So we must humbly seek His face with prayer and repentance and turn from our wicked ways. After you ask for forgiveness, you must continue on to know the Lord. Do not go back to the former addictions and way of life. Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. Hallelujah. John the Beloved said, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in good health, even as thy soul prospereth. Your home, your marriage, your children, your land, He will perfect everything the Word of God says that concerns you. We are ripe and ready for an Ezekiel's Boneyard Revival. We, the church, are many. More Christians now than ever before, but we are exceedingly dry. One pastor had a church of thousands and preached on repentance and ended up with a little more than 200 people in his church. Folks don't want to repent, amen. They want to stay dry and they want to stay, amen, in the world. You can't hold hands with the devil and then hold on with God with the other hand. You've got to go all the way or you won't go no way. I believe that we're ready for a double portion revival. Yeah. Elisha's portion, the latter and the former reign. Joel said in chapter 2, verse 23, be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for He hath given you the former rain moderately, and He will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain, in the first month. Even the coming of the Lord is dependent upon this double portion revival. Jesus said before He comes, before that rain and latter rain comes, amen, He's got to come first. The revival has to come first. Then Jesus said that He would return. Even the coming of the Lord is dependent upon this. In James 5:7 it says, be patient, therefore, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and have long patience for it until he receives the early and latter rain. Zechariah said this in chapter 10, verse 1. Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. So the Lord will make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to everyone, grass in the field. We are living in the greatest time. Listen to some of the great men of old express the feelings of this day we live in. I told you before about these great men of God that look for the time that we're living in right now. But we've got to do something to break this thing on. We've got to pray for revival. Dr. Charles S. Price said, he spoke to them and declared it is a day when the power of the Holy Spirit is to be poured out in such a measure upon consecrated, surrendered, yielded lives of godly men and women. Hallelujah. That's the manifestation of the power of God. Amen. This manifestation of the power of the Lord will exceed anything the world has known since the glory fell at Pentecost. He further states, perhaps you wonder why I'm writing this. It is because my soul is aflame with the revelation that we are living in a new day. If I know my heart, I'm writing for something that will rock the earth by irresistible majesty and glory and power of its advent. He continues with these tremendous words. My spirit is aflame with the glory of it. I am alive with the expectancy of the glorious revelation which is to come in the full fulfillment of the promise of the Lord.
Amen.
Great man of God looking for for this time we're living in. Smith Wigglesworth, a man that raised his wife a couple times from the dead, until the point where God said to him, "You got to let her go." Because every time she'd die, he'd lift her up, snatch her up, and command life to come back at her. And he had such a relationship with God that death would flee and life would come. That's what we're looking for. But Smith Wigglesworth said this, the great Pentecostal prophet that carried and circled the earth for Jesus, proclaiming the healing Christ, declared that after he was gone, a greater and mightier revival would come.
Amen.
How can it get greater and more mightier than that? Man, if you've ever read some of the exploits of Brother Wigglesworth, they were amazing. He was a plumber by trade, but a man of God that stirred the hearts of millions. And I want to tell you that God's looking for some men and women that will consecrate themselves to God fully. He's looking for some men and women that say, "Lord, use me." You know what? You might not think you're anything or anyone, but God takes those things that seem small in men's eyes and He makes them great. I want to tell you something. You don't need a lot. All you need is God.
Amen.
Amen. Amy Simple McPherson, for all you women that think, amen, that you can't do anything, spoke of the glorious revival. And even Dr. Horace Bushnell, a denominational minister of another generation, spoke of this great revival when all the gifts of the Spirit would be restored and the church would have first century power. Back to the book of Acts, back to all the gifts of the Spirit, back to the Holy Ghost moving in your life. See, we came to a point when God, amen, was blessing people with the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost was moving in those nine gifts, and a lot of people thought they were the bearers of the gifts. They owned the gifts. You don't own the gift. The Bible says that the Holy Ghost divides them and uses you severally as He wills. Amen. You are a submitted vessel to God. When you submit yourself fully, therefore, unto God, God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all you're able to ask or think, according to the power that works within you. That power is the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The power of God's love and God's ability in Jesus Christ, His beloved Son. How many of you today are looking for that revival?
Amen.
How many of you today just really want to see God saturate your soul with the rain, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost?
Amen.
Sister Mary, we used to see it just about in every service where people would give messages, an interpretation of the message would come. Somebody stand up and prophesy. Amen. We don't see that much anymore. We see people getting a word of knowledge and giving a word of wisdom. Amen. It's hard to give people words today because they don't want to receive them most of the time. But you need to open yourself up to God.
Amen.
You need to find out that some people's not against you. They're totally for you.
Amen.
Some people's not trying to hurt you. They're actually trying to help you. But the devil, he'll come in. The Bible said he will. And he'll come in as a sheep, amen. But he's a wolf. He's a wolf in sheep's clothing. And I want to tell you something. He's coming to the world today. He's made his way into America. He started overseas. He's made his way into America, disguised himself as a sheep, but he's coming as a wolf. But I'm here to tell you, if you'll serve Jesus Christ, if you begin to lift Jesus up, the Bible says the gates of hell shall not prevail. The devil doesn't have a chance against the mighty force of God that will be in His people, that will stand up and say, "God, I'm ready, and God, I'm willing. And Lord, if I'm not ready, if my faith is not up to par," be like the man that told Jesus, "I got faith." And then Jesus looked at him and said, "But Lord, if it's not big enough, go ahead and increase it. Increase my faith." There ain't nothing wrong with praying for more faith. There's nothing wrong with praying for more love. There's nothing wrong with praying that you get out there and witness more. There's nothing wrong with you saying, "God, send me some people that's open to your word that I might encourage them to live for you." God's looking for a few good people to begin this revival. Where are you going to be? See, if you don't find yourself at an old-fashioned altar, if you don't find yourself crying out to God, if you don't find yourself forsaking those wicked ways, if you don't find yourself coming out from among the people of the world and letting God know that you're here and you want to be one of His light bearers, amen, You are the light bearers. You are the one to bring in the light. Jesus was the light while he was in this world, but he says you have the light now. You need to go out and lift Jesus up. You need to go out and tell people, look, there's no sense in getting mad when somebody tells you the truth. Truth makes you free. Don't get mad, get glad. Thank God for somebody has the courage to tell you the truth. Amen? Thank God for somebody who has enough love in their heart to tell you the truth. And nobody that tells you the truth says anything that they want to hurt you with. They want to help you. Amen. So you need to just figure out if it's the devil coming or if it's just somebody with a bitter spirit coming or just somebody who likes to stir up strife. So there's a whole lot of things that's going to be trying to work in your life. But let God work in your life. Let go of the old and take hold of the new. The Bible says break those chains of the past. Amen. Run that race with patience. I want you to stand to your feet this morning. We're going to get ready to take communion today. Let me say something about communion. The Bible didn't say don't take communion. The Bible said examine yourself. Before I take it, I always examine myself. And I ask God to forgive me of all my sins, known or unknown. It doesn't make any difference. If I've offended anyone, done anything that I'm not aware of, I want God to forgive me of everything. Because the Bible says some people take of the communion and they're unworthy. And therefore they are sick and they fall asleep. And that word means they die because they take of it unworthily. We don't want anybody to die. We don't want nobody to get sick. We want you to be blessed. But we also want you to participate. So you need to just clear your heart with God. When you start coming down, get a cup of juice.